Hi everybody, this is Sherry, and welcome back to the third part of the hip replacement journey series that I had with my dad. So just checking in, it's 5 weeks after the surgery. I talked to my dad this morning and he's doing A-okay, doing everything like the doctor ordered, and he's doing a really good job. So today is his last checkup with the doctor to make sure that everything is healing well, which my dad says it is, that he's walking well, that the length of his legs are okay, and just basically an overall checkup before the doctor gives him a thumbs up like all is good in the hip world. So in this third takeaway, which I will say is a video series that really has two pieces, I'm going to be talking a little bit about the operation of a hip replacement itself so that you understand what exercises are important in the post-operative stage. So basically, there are two approaches for hip replacement surgeries. There's the posterior, which means the backside, and there's the anterior, which means the front side approach. So what that means is that the doctor does the surgical incision either on the backside, which is through your gluteus maximus muscle, your butt cheek basically, and the anterior is basically coming into the front side, a little bit more where there's not a lot of heavy muscles in that area. So what's the difference and why would you want one over the other? Well, I'll tell you that the posterior is much more popular right now because the anterior approach is fairly new technology. They're saying it's about 10 years old, so more and more it's going to become a little bit more of the popular way to go, but right now the posterior so far surpasses the anterior in terms of the approach of the surgery. So let's talk about the two and about the healing process and the movements after each of those surgical procedures. So let's talk a little bit about the posterior, which is what my dad got. Well, I'm going to tell you, I'm a yoga teacher and I have been teaching to seniors and I've learned about joint replacements and hip replacements and knee replacements. And the one thing that I heard is don't get a posterior hip replacement, get an anterior. Well, when I went to my dad's doctor, I asked the doctor, well, what approach do you take, the anterior or the posterior? And he said, I do posterior. Well, the yoga teacher inside of me wanted to go, oh, no, really? But I didn't. I said, well, why is that? He said, because it's not going in as blind as the anterior. And it's something that I've been doing a long time very successfully. So needless to say, I wasn't going to argue with the orthopedic doctor on how he was going to do the surgery for my dad. And it ended up fine. My dad had the posterior surgery, which is an incision of about, this long, what is that, 8 to 10 inches possibly. He had 22 staples, a kind of a diagonal cut in his backside basically. And what they do is they cut through the muscles to get into the hip joint and then they put in the mechanical device and then they stitch you back up with staples. You can imagine they go through a lot of muscle tissue in that gluteus maximus muscle. And that's what takes a little bit longer in the healing process. So that's why the posterior has a little bit of the disadvantages in that. Now the anterior, where they would just make a 3 to 4 inch incision in the front side of your hip, they don't cut any muscles and they don't detach any tendons. They kind of move things out to the side and then they go in there and put the mechanical device and then they stitch you back up. So the healing of the anterior approach is so much shorter. They said it can be 4 weeks for anterior healing and 8 weeks for posterior healing, just because of the tissue that needs to be basically repaired and healed. Right? Makes sense, yes. So the anterior approach is becoming much more popular. As doctors get trained in the new method, they will be much more confident, of course, in doing that process. So when you're debating on a hip replacement surgery, make sure you talk to your doctor about what he feels comfortable, she feels comfortable doing, and what you feel is best for you and your healing journey. So secondly, let me talk a little bit about the exercises you want to do in the post-operative stage and why you might do some differently if you had posterior surgery versus anterior approach surgery. Well, you can imagine the posterior, there is a big incision there that could break open if you were to move your hip in a direction that is not necessarily the right direction. And there's three cautions with the posterior hip replacement. Number one, is do not bend beyond 90 degrees at your hips. So right now I am sitting in 90 degrees. As soon as I move my torso forward, I am bending beyond 90 degrees. You see that? Do you understand why that might be a little precarious for the posterior? Yeah, because the incision is right here, right? And any kind of pressure there could almost break open that. So posterior approaches we have to keep in mind, no flexion of the hips beyond 90 degrees. This is 90 degrees, this is anything beyond. This equates to this movement, right? Going down to reach something from the floor, right? That's going to be beyond that 90 degrees. So they give you these kind of contraptions in the hospital to help you, kind of occupational therapy-wise, get your shoes on, get your socks on, right? So you don't have to do all this bending and reaching and tilting of your pelvis to get down there. So I won't go into those, but I'm guaranteeing you, they will send you home with a kit. Guess what? My mom did all the work. My dad didn't use any of those things. That's how it goes with a 67-year-old marriage. And the second precaution for a posterior approach is do not cross your legs. As you can see here, if my incision here is on the backside and I cross my legs, that's pulling that hip joint and pulling the skin as well a little bit beyond what we would like it to be in the healing process. So no crossing of the legs in the posterior approach. And the third one is no pigeon toes. Okay, pigeon toed is this movement. Watch. You see how my foot is angled in? So when I do that, my femur moves in the socket, right? So that rotation, don't want that. So no pigeon toed, don't walk pigeon toed, don't do a movement that's pigeon toed. So in review, there's three things you don't want to do for a posterior approach. You don't want to bend beyond 90 degrees. You don't want to cross one leg over the other. And you don't want to be pigeon toed. You're going to ask me, I know you're going to ask me, what about the anterior approach? Well, I did a lot of research and there's really not many movement precautions with the anterior. So that's kind of nice. And I think that's one reason why it's going to become more popular, because the movement restrictions are nil, if not just a little bit. I do have one that I'm thinking might be a caution because you have the incision here on the front side of your hip. I'm going to say be careful of the extension of your hip. So this is hip extension, but this is hip extension, right? Or hip extension. We don't want any of those. I'm thinking for an anterior. But otherwise, flexion beyond 90 degrees, okay. Crossing of the leg, okay. Pigeon-toed, okay. So they say, I'm always going to say, follow your doctor's guidance in all of this. Okay, so are we ready to do some of the exercises? And we're going to be focused on four things. We're going to get our hip through a more range of motion. We're going to make sure we get that hip to be flexible, to get that hip strong, and lastly, we want to make sure that our gait is walking straight and aligned. We don't want any crooked walkings, right? So we're going to have three parts to this. We're going to have a seated version, a standing version, and a lying on the mat, or what I would say lying in the bed version, because that's what they gave my dad.